everyone, what's up? My name is Joss, and welcome back to my channel, Squibbles Reads. So lately, I've been reading some amazing romance books. I've loved reading romance for probably like more than 10 years, but I have found that over time, I thought I was reading the same story over and over again. But thankfully, over the past year or so, I've found that there are some new voices, original stories, and fresh takes on tried and true romance tropes. And I know that a lot of people use the word tropes negatively, and when I use it, I am merely talking about like some archetypes and themes that we see a lot. Before I start, this is really selfish of me, but I haven't found a really good romance book using my favorite trope, which is like the one that got away or like the one that came back with unfinished business. So if you guys know of any books like that, definitely leave them down below in the comments. Pause this video and leave it down below because I am dying for a good book with that theme. But anyways, today I'm going to tell you about five romance books that I have read lately and absolutely loved. Two of them I talk about on my channel, but three of them I don't think I've ever mentioned besides very briefly here or there. So without any further ado, let's get into the books. The first book I'm going to talk about, I actually just finished this past weekend during the 24 and 48 hour readathon. This is a book that comes out today and it's called The Wedding Date by Jasmine Guillory. So our female protagonist, her name is Alexa Monroe. She is an African-American woman and she works for the city of Berkeley's mayor as the chief of staff. And her primary goal is to put together an arts program to benefit underprivileged youth in the Bay Area. So one day she is at the Fairmont Hotel in San Francisco. There is a power outage and the elevator shuts down during the power outage and she gets stuck in the elevator with a super hot dude whose name is Drew Nichols, and he actually turns out to be a pediatric surgeon. Like, yes please. Drew is going to the wedding of his best friend and his ex-girlfriend, which should be a very interesting time, and he is part of the wedding party and he really doesn't want to go, so he needs to find a date to accompany him. He spontaneously asks Alexa to accompany him and she says yes. So this is like the fake relationship to real relationships, which is absolutely one of my favorite romance tropes. Drew also lives in LA, so they have a long distance relationship, and on the night of the wedding they end up hooking up and they can't stop thinking about each other thereafter, and then we see their relationship progress. What I love about this book is how much real life and day-to-day stuff we get to see. So after the wedding, Alexa and Drew, they go back to their regular jobs. Alexa goes to work. Sometimes she has to put her phone away during meetings with like government officials and people who are trying to give her funds for her project. They're really tired after work. They aren't just like robots that you see in some romance books who can stay up all night without any regard to the consequences at work, and usually they don't get very many consequences at work, but this is like just day-to-day stuff, which I really appreciate. Alexa's work also involves the justice system and race and wealth disparity, and this is something that she's super passionate about because of things in her own past. So she's dating Drew, and Drew is a Caucasian man, and he makes some comments throughout the book that clearly come from a place of just never having experienced these things. So they talk about them and he comes to acknowledge his own privilege, and these conversations are especially important because we see how parts of their relationship work even though they come from different backgrounds. There were also times where Alexa, who is absolutely beautiful, she feels really insecure and out of place because of the Eurocentric beauty norms, and at multiple times throughout the book she is surrounded by women who fit these Eurocentric beauty norms in a Western world that values these norms, which is absolutely insecurities and stuff that I have felt personally. I think portraying those insecurities is really smart and just adds more and more layers to her character. The overall tone of the book is really fun and lighthearted, but it frames the relationship kind of in the day-to-day life of like people in their late 20s to early 30s really well, trying to balance excelling in like the pinnacle of their careers also with this new budding relationship, which is super cute. It's really hot. I highly recommend this one. So my next recommendation is called Take the Lead, which is the first book in the Dance Off series by Alexa Daria. This is an own voices romance series where the female protagonists in books 1 and 2 are both Puerto Rican and the male protagonists come from different backgrounds. So like I said, we have the first book, which is Take the Lead, and also the second book called Dance With Me. I like the first book significantly better than the second one, so I'm only gonna recommend the first one to you today. This takes place on a TV show that's called The Dance Off, which is basically Dancing with the Stars. So there are pro dancers who take on a celebrity partner, and throughout the season, they do ballroom dancing every week. They learn a new routine, and then every week, one couple is eliminated from the show. Our female protagonist, her name is Gina Morales, and it's her 5th season on the show. She has never won or made it to the finals, and she meets her new partner, and his name is Stone, and he has become famous because he's on this reality show called Living Wild, where he and his family live in the wilderness in Alaska. Gina also struggles with being portrayed as like the spicy Latina woman in entertainment, and because when she goes on auditions, she is typecast and pigeonholed into these roles, and we see her frustration. Stone also has his own struggles. His mom is diagnosed with a medical diagnosis, and their family is not well off enough to pay for all of her treatment and stuff. stuff, which is why he chose to go on the dance-off show. They start off really kind of unhappy with the pairing. Stone is like, oh, why'd I have to do this? But eventually things start to heat up. They start dancing with each other. They start becoming attracted to each other. And their chemistry is, it's good. However, they do have to keep their relationship from a secret because of the tabloids and this one, like, either producer or director lady that they work with that blackmails them multiple times throughout their book and tries to screw up their relationship. I personally love really any story that has dance in it because I used to dance at a studio and I loved it so much. I will read basically any book about dance, whether it's like ballroom, ballet, hip hop, I'm here for absolutely all of it. The next book that I'm going to talk about, you won't find it in the romance section, but the romance is like a pretty good majority of this book. You've heard me talk about this book before. I just can't stop. This book is Autobiography by Christina Lauren. This is about Tanner. He is bisexual and he moves to a small town in Utah called Provo, where there is a large Mormon population and he's moved there from California. He was out in California, but no one in Provo knows that he is bisexual. So Tanner's friend Autumn dares him one day to take this seminar class where the task is to write a novel over the course of the entire semester. And the person who is assisting the class is a student named Sebastian from the previous year who has made it really big in the book world with his own novel that he wrote in the class. Tanner is instantly attracted to him and they do have an amazing chemistry. But what I really liked about this book is that Tanner's writing is directly linked and reflective of their relationship and they have this muse-like quality to their relationship and Sebastian, I guess in some senses, kind of becomes his muse. Not in like a weird creepy way, but Sebastian like motivates and betters his writing. And you see it because Tanner is just really hesitant to share it with anyone because it's just so personal to him. Sebastian is also Mormon and Tanner is not, and Tanner's parents have a complicated relationship with the Mormon church. So it talks about how people approach relationships when they come from totally separate belief systems while setting boundaries and also fostering like love and care and intimacy in the relationship. So when I was reading this book, I did the two things that basically solidify a 4.5 or a 5-star rating for me. Number one, I cried. And number two, I like highlighted and I wrote down quotes and I used them in an Instagram caption. I adore when quotes really resonate with me in books, but I especially adore quotes about writing. The feelings that I feel about this book is exactly why I read and why I love connecting to books is to feel this feeling. Pick this book up. You will not regret it. My next recommendation is a trilogy. It is called The Sins of the Cities series by KJ Charles. I have read the first book and the second book. I have yet to read the third one. The first one, I've also talked about this one, is called An Unseen Attraction, and the second one is called An Unnatural Vice. These stories all take place in Victorian London, and they have romance, but there also is like a mystery or suspense element to them. The first one is about Clem. He runs a lodging house, and also Rowley. He is a taxidermist who is staying at the lodging house. They start to flirt and become intimate, and they're extremely attracted to each other. The mystery element in this book surrounds one day at the lodging house, they find a dead body, and so they investigate who and why and all that stuff. This is more of a slow burn romance. Both of them definitely proceed with caution. Clem experiences some anxiety symptoms, especially in situations where he is like overstimulated or there's a lot of sensory input. For example, like bright flashing lights, crowded situations, loud noises, just a lot of like people touching and squeezing and like pushing and all of that stuff. Rolly is also a taxidermist. He's extremely introverted. He doesn't have a lot of friends. So we see how they learn to balance what they need while caring for what the other person needs and setting their own boundaries. Clem is also discriminated against throughout the book because he is half British and half Indian. So for the color of his skin, and you can see Rolly hurting when Clem is hurt because they just love each other so much. But Rolly also acknowledges his own privilege when he sees Clem being hurt. So that first book revolved around like a new and budding romance, but the second one is a classic hate to love trope. So like I said, the second book is called An Unnatural Vice, and one of our protagonists, Nathaniel, we meet in the first book because he is a friend of Clem. Nathaniel is a lawyer, but now he's a journalist that exposes people who are apparently spiritualists, and they tell people who are grieving that they can communicate with their loved one when really they have no background in psychic work or the metaphysical or any of that stuff. So they're really just exploiting grieving people, which is totally shitty. However, the love interest, Justin, he is one of these spiritualists. So this is where like the strong hate to love stuff comes in. Justin also comes from a poor background. He was born in a workhouse and he grew up like in the gutters and he had to do anything he could to make ends meet. The mystery of this one surrounds a secret that Justin has about this aristocratic family that when and if it is exposed could really screw them up. This one is most definitely more gritty. The first one was like heartwarming. The relationship felt really warm and fuzzy. This one is like, I absolutely hate you and I want to expose you. And then they get together and it's is steamy. So a different start to the relationship, but I think both are equally well done. And the last book that I'm going to recommend actually doesn't come out until the end of February. Sorry, guys. But if you want to pre-order it, you definitely can. I also finished this one this past weekend, and this is called A Princess in Theory by Alyssa Cole. I have to mention this book because this is genuinely one of the funniest books that I have read in my entire life, and I'm not laughing at the book. I'm most definitely laughing with the book. With books and movies that are trying to be intentionally funny, honestly, like 9 times out of 10, I don't find them very funny at all, but this was hilarious. I laughed out loud multiple times. Besides the humor, the theme of this book is like a hidden identity romance. It also is a princess story, and our female protagonist is a woman in science, so definitely all things that I love. So our protagonist, her name is Naledi Smith. She was in the foster system when she was a kid, but now she's in grad school and she works in a really rigorous science lab and she studies epidemiology. She has to make all the money that she possibly can to put herself through school, so she works at like this event slash catering place at the university that she's at to host events for scientists and guests that come into the university, like lecturers and speakers. And she is not happy with the emails that are coming into her inbox that she believes are spam, and they are telling her that she is betrothed to the heir to the throne of Tosolo, which is a small African kingdom. Little does she know, these emails are in fact not spam, and Prince Tobiso goes to the university that she works and studies at to try and find her, and he mistakenly shows up at a dinner that Naledi is working at. She thinks he is a new person that just got hired whose name is Jamal, and he doesn't correct her. So before she knows it, she is in this whirlwind romance with him. She really likes him a lot. They become intimate. And he is deep into the charade of being Jamal, and she has no idea that he's a prince. So obviously for this one, you do have to suspend your disbelief for it, but just know that going in and you will definitely have a good time. Lady is also dedicated to her research in the epidemiology lab, but she's constantly undermined and gaslighted by this obnoxious dude who works with her. She also frames everything like cognitively and scientifically. She's guarded because of her background and she is dating someone wealthier. Tobiso doesn't tell her that he's exactly a prince, but things come up and she thinks it's a little weird because he doesn't know how to take the subway. He doesn't know how to order food from a street vendor, just all things that would kind of implicate that he comes from a different background than she does. She also doesn't want to be pitied or like patted on the head, but she finds that he supports her in a way that doesn't undermine or take away her voice or her agency. However, of course, the big plot point revolves around when and if she ever finds out that he's a prince and what she does with that information and how it impacts their relationship. This book is adorable, it's hot, and I think it gives voice to characters that we don't see or hear from a lot in romance novels, and it is about damn time. So that is it for this video. I will probably be doing another one of these very soon because I've been really into reading romance lately. Again, if you guys know of any like one that got away slash unfinished business romances, definitely leave them down in the comments below. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you in my next video. Bye.